On behalf of the University of Arkansas Karma, I'd like to thank you for meeting with us today and talking to us about your experiences of living in exile from Tibet. I would like you to state your name and your age to start off for us.
Yeah, this is Karma Yeshi, and I'm 50 years old and father of three children. Eldest one is my son, who is studying in BA first year, and the younger one is daughter. She's in high school, class 11. The youngest one is my son, is class 8. So, yeah.
And where were you born?
I was born in India, in the Sikkim, Gangtok. When my parents came from Tibet in 1959, so they were like based in Gangtok during the road construction of the Himalayan border. And I was born on the roadside at the early 60s when my parents were working in the there.
You never lived in Tibet?
No, I was born in exile. My parents came from Tibet, they got married here, so I was born in exile. Yeah.
Did they ever recall to you any early memories of Tibet or any memories they had of living in Tibet?
From my father's side, I have all my religious back in Tibet, but I have most of my religious from mother's side here. But in case of me, at least my parents came from Tibet. My father, mother, they came from Tibet. In case of my children, not only they are born in exile, but their parents also. Myself, my wife, both are born in exile. So it's little like third generation already coming up in exile. So my parents, my father already passed away when I got elected to the vice president of TYC in 1995. So then he used to tell me lots of his work. He spent almost two times in jails in Tibet. Like that, yeah.
Did they ever tell you about any stories of coming from Tibet to India?
The place where my father come from is called Sakya in central Tibet. So it's not that far from Indian border. So he had not that tough time while crossing border. But when he got first arrested to the jail by the Chinese people, then he had a hard time living. Then his first wife got expired, then again he got arrested, then his mother got expired, then sometime later he got released from the jail, then he escaped too. So he had a little, not that much tough time while crossing the border, but my mother was very young, so she had a little tough, because she had to walk all the way with her parents. So they met in Gangtok in Sikkim, so they got married there.
Your father was arrested in Tibet while he was there?
Chinese
in the, why was he arrested?
In our area, His Holiness Sakya Tenzin used to be the head lama of that area. So my father was helping His Holiness Sakya Tenzin to escape like that. That was one part. And secondly, my family, the father used to be the head of village called Palak. That very head of the village, they consider, these people are kind of so-called aristocrat, they are like that. So that's why he got arrested two times, yeah.
Twice.
Both, yeah.
For helping the Dalai Lama.
And then not only the Dalai Lama, but also the native Lama of that very region called Sakya Rinpoche, yeah.
Okay. Did he ever recall to you any memories of being in the jail?
Yeah, when he was in jail, he had a tough time. Then he don't speak Chinese. Of course, there were some Tibetans who was working for Chinese. So these people, the interpreter, the one person who was working in our family that time, who was helping my father, he was also there as a Chinese policeman. Okay, then he was the person who helped my father to escape from the jail, like that. So he had a tough time, but he couldn't also attend the funeral of his mother when he was in jail, yeah.
And you said a Chinese policeman helped your father escape from jail?
A Tibetan was working for the Chinese. Yeah.
Tibetan who?
That person, very person, used to work in our family before the Chinese came to Tibet.
And so, do you know how long the journey was that your parents took from Tibet to India?
So maybe what he told me when I was young, he used to tell me, you are the fugitives of Tibet, you have to work for Tibet, you have to serve the Tibetan community, you have to serve the Dalai Lama, like that, time and again. So that's why, the problem, my father and mother had a huge age gap, almost 21 years gap. My mother was very young. When she was 19, I was born. we have a gap of only 19 years, but my father was very old, like that. So he used to tell me lots about Tibet. Then he also, like, he said, almost he took 48 days crossing the border. He had to escape, he had to hide. Then nights he stay somewhere, there was no food left, like that. So he had a tough time, like when he reached India, they don't speak the language. Then the climate was not suitable for our people that time. So like that, so he was working on the roadside to India, like that. Yeah.
Do you still have any family members living in Tibet?
My father's, yes. Lots of, almost all my father's side relatives, they are still in Tibet. But for me, it's difficult to contact them. If I contact them, then again, they will be in trouble because I'm working for the Tibetan administration here. So that's why I hardly contact my relatives inside Tibet. If I try to contact them, instead of helping, then they will be in trouble. So I don't want not only my family, but almost same to every Tibetan living in exile. They all have their relatives inside Tibet. But for them, contacting these people inside Tibet directly is a little difficult here.
Because you're a member of parliament.
Yeah, I'm a member of parliament. I was a very visible figure of the exile community. That's why it's a little difficult here.
Have you had any success contacting them, or do you just not try?
My mother, my brother, they used to do, but I try to avoid.
Is your mother still alive?
Yeah, my mother's still alive, yeah.
So when your family went from Tibet to India, where did they first settle down?
My father, first reached Sikkim in Sikkim. That's a Nathula Pass. We have a Nathula border. Nathula Pass, backside is Tibet, this side is Sikkim. So they lived in Sikkim for almost 3 years when I was born there. Then we moved to Dharamsala. That time, I don't remember, I was very young. Just right near this very place, we had our own tent. So my father, mother, both were working for the construction of this His Holiness temple and plus His Holiness residence. So they were working here. They stayed for almost 3 years here. Then we were sent to Tibetan settlements in the lower India. So like my sister, younger sister was born here in Dharamsala. 3 years in Sikkim, 3 years in Dharamsala, then we moved to Tibetan settlements.
Is your sister your only sibling? Or do you have other siblings?
My sister, she got married and then she has her own two sons, two daughters. They all are grown up, yeah.
Can you describe for me any early struggles that you had when you were growing up here in Tibet or in India?
See, like in case of me, I got all my education free of cost, okay? Like I've been to the village school where we used to call it Center School for Tibetans. And I did my primary school. Then I went to Center School for Tibetan. The Laozi is very almost 3 hours from here where I studied my high school. When in the year 1981 or 82, I joined Tibetan Youth Congress when I was in school. So we used to pay 50 paisa per month, 6 rupees a year as a membership fee from my own pocket money to become a member of TYC. So that time I was just an ordinary member, just paying money and then little active in the political, and also I was little active in the students. I was a student leader also in the school. Then after finishing my high school, I joined establishment number 22, which is called, is supported by Government of India. So it's a kind of military. So I went there for training. Almost I did 4 months training. Then I got a scholarship. Then I got discharged from the military service. Then I went to Punjab University, Chandigarh. From there I did my graduation, BA, everything. Then when I was in Chandigarh, I was the leader of Tibetan Youth Congress branch there, little active. Then I was a teacher for a while, almost I taught in the school, Center School of Tibetan, for almost 4+ years. Then I left teaching job because I got elected to the vice president of Tibetan Youth Congress Central Executive Committee. Then I became more visible in the politics. When I was in Youth Congress, I used to lead many workshops, leadership trainings, and also many political rallies in Delhi. When Li Peng came here, we did a demonstration. I got arrested 3-4 times. I went to Tihar jail in Delhi for almost 3 times, every time maybe more than a week. Then like that. So then also in 1999, I was in Geneva. I was on fast. unto death for almost 26 days. I should be die, should have died, but somehow I'm still alive. Because we were doing a hunger strike in front of those days, it just was called United Nations Human Rights Commission. Now we call UN Human Rights Council. So when Mary Robinson was the chairperson of the UN Human Rights Commission, we were doing hunger strike in front of her office in Geneva. So like that, I was on hunger strike for 26 days. And the ninth day of my hunger strike, I got 3 minutes opportunity to address the UN Human Rights Commission. Hardly when I started speaking, my health was very weak, but still, the moment I stood up reading my paper, the Chinese stopped my speech. Okay, point of order that Karma cannot speak, he's a Tibetan. How can he address the UN Human Rights Commission like that? Anyhow, I managed to continue my speech and I spoke for 3 minutes like that. So we were three persons, myself, my own colleague who was the General Secretary of TYC, Tibetan Youth Congress, and then one very senior person who spent almost 26 years in Chinese prison in Tibet, who escaped from Tibet later, and then he lives in Swiss. So we were three doing hunger strike like that. So that's how I continued. And then one interesting part, is in the year 2001, when Beijing was bidding for the Olympic 2008, I was in Moscow. So to represent TYC, I went to Moscow, kind of doing a demonstration. There was one hotel fully packed by Chinese delegates. We went to all hotels, we put a sticker everywhere, lived, bathroom, public places, saying no Olympics to China until Tibet is free, like that. No? So when the 2001, July 13 was the bidding day, so we did a demonstration on July 12th. Then we were arrested. So I spent almost 24 hours in Russian jail. I can't speak Russian, they don't speak English. So we have some people coming from Swiss, two Tibetans, two Swiss, and then two Americans from US and one English guy from London to protest Chinese bid for. We were hardly a bunch of 10 people. And the Chinese delegates almost 700 plus, but still we managed to do a lot of protest. So that's how, the one interesting part, July 10th, I addressed a press conference in the Russian press club. We booked a press club. And we said, we are going to have a press. Okay, I paid some money, everything. And next day, I received a call from that very club saying that, Karma, we are sorry, we cannot permit you to, because they got the pressure from Chinese embassy. Okay, then next day, I said, even I will not take my advance money back. I will do anyway, because we had already paid our money, and we are saying nothing. We are just making a press statement, that's it. Now for that, China don't have to worry about, but somehow, I said, if you don't allow, we'll do in front of your office, that's it. But anyway, he allowed us. Then, I thought hardly 20 people come. That day, almost 90 plus people came. I thank Chinese embassy, because of their pressure, they thought, oh, what this Karma has to speak? Nothing. I have to just read some, hardly two, three paragraphs about why Tibet, how Tibetans are suffering inside Tibet, why world shouldn't give China to host the Olympic, such a prestigious game. But somehow we lost. We tried our best, but somehow we lost. Then the China won the thing. I spent almost 24 hours in Russian jail. Then that's how, then 2004, I got elected to the parliament for my first time in the 13th house of Tibetan parliament in the by-election. Then again, I got re-elected in 2006, again re-elected in 2011. This is my third term as a member of parliament. So I led many demonstrations, many meeting lots of world leaders, Indian parliament, world parliamentarians to request them to support Tibet issue like that. So that's how we do normally, yeah.
So you worked for the Tibetan Children's Village for...
Not Tibetan Children's Village. So in the Tibetan, first the school in exile was started in Missouri. When His Holiness first came to exile in 1959, we were first having our office in Missouri in those days it's called UP, Uttar Pradesh. Now it's called Uttarakhand, okay, change. Then we stayed 1 year there. Then from there, His Holiness and all the Tibetan government in exile moved to Dharamsala, okay, a year later. So there we started Central School for Tibetans. What happened, that time Indian Prime Minister Pandit Nehruji was alive, the first Prime Minister of India. If every Tibetan children was sent to Indian schools those days, there would be less Tibetan children, more Indian schools. But His Holiness and the Pandit Nehru discussed that we should have our own school. So that's why the government of India supported this Central School for Tibetan. It's called Central Tibetan Schools Administration. It has its office in Delhi, fully funded by Government of India. That was the first school in Mussoorie, the first Tibetan school. So there were some 50 children. There were not only a children, there were also a teacher. The teacher comes students. So they were teaching the younger children. They were themselves learning from Indian teacher like that. So that's what the first school. That's how, like, His Honor is given top priority to the Tibetan education. Then the Tibetan monks, huge suffering. And when they crossed the border in Assam, those days it's called Northeast Frontiers of Assam. Now it's called Assam. So they're hot, very hot place. Maybe some 300 Tibetan monks were staying in a place called Missamari. Very, very hot. People were dying. No, climate was not suitable. Language was probably like that. So that's how it has lots of problems. But still, he managed to keep Tibetan Buddhism alive, Tibetan language alive, Tibetan culture alive. When Tibet was free, the people from Himalayan belt, they used to go to Tibet to study Tibetan Buddhism. Right now, the Ganden Tripa, the highest seat holder of the Gelugpa tradition Tibetan, he's a Ladakhi, he's not the Tibetan. He studied in Tibet, now he's holding the place. Now the Tibetan, all these Himalayan people, they cannot go to, otherwise China claiming there's, you have every freedom, Tibetan can practice religion, Tibetan can study. If that is true, why not these Himalayan people are going to Tibet? Why they are coming to our community in exile in South India? Like that, so that's why His Honor is given top priority to Tibetan education, then settling the Tibetan huge settlement all over India. There are around 47 plus Tibetan settlements throughout India, Nepal, Bhutan, to welfare of Tibetan, like that. So education was given top priority. That's how we were able to keep our language, culture alive. So we live in exile. Living in exile, daily our market language is Indian. Hindi language, we have to, but still we can, we have our own language, we have our, preserve our culture. So if you go back to Tibet, they are claiming everything, but unfortunately, if you look, go to Lhasa, if you don't speak Chinese, I think it will be very difficult to buy any single item. So that's how, like, so that's why, like, given priority to the education, like people like me, and back in Tibet, I think I would be, like, if I was in Tibet, then I don't think I would have such education. All because of His Holiness, Government of India, foreign supporter, all those Tibetan senior people who came from Tibet, who worked for us. Now it's our duty to serve our community. Now, next time it's my children's duty, their duty to serve our community, like that. So that's how we were able to keep our culture, language, identity intact here in exile.
When you were helping to establish that school, what challenges did you face as one of the members?
When I was a teacher, it's not that difficult. The school was already established. When I was a student in that very school, see, some maybe the year 1973-4, I was in, like, in the very primary. We have very limited classrooms. Class 3 facing the back side, class 4 facing other side. We have only two teachers. One teacher will say, oh, now class 4, he will teach class 4. Then he'll say, okay, look, class 4, you do your self-study. Then he will move to the same room, he'll move to the other side. And he will teach class food like that. We had a lot of suffering, no proper food. But still, food luxury was not a real thing. We need real education. That's how, like, challenges senior people had. For us, it was easy when it was already established, only to teach them, to give a proper education. So that's why, not only the modern education, but also the our values, culture, everything should be kept alive. So that's why, luckily, in the Indian school Board of Education, they recognize Tibetan as a language now. So that's why, that's one good part. It's not only helped us, it also helped whole Himalayan belt. If Tibetan people didn't come to exile, I think, like, Ladakhi people must have lost their culture, the Himalayan belt must have lost their culture. Ladakh to Arunachal, whole this long border, mostly they have impact to Tibetan culture. So all their culture got revived because of us in exile, because of His Holiness. Yeah.
Are you saying that there are some benefits of being exiled from Tibet?
To exile from?
Yeah.
Tibet in the sense?
From what I understood, you said that it helps benefit some certain lineages, being in exile as far as the culture goes, or?
Like living in exile, it's a home away from home, it's difficult, but still, like, unlike other exile community, we had a wonderful leader, we had a wonderful administration. That's why we could keep our language, culture alive. That's one part. And then, like, before 2008, lots of Tibetan students from Tibet used to come here to study. China claiming they give every free education, but somehow people are coming here. Why? But they don't have a proper education. Inside Tibet, like they say, every Tibetan can study Tibetan, but medium of instruction is already changed to Chinese. The Chinese is the first language, whereas Tibetan is our first language, mother tongue. Like that, so that's why Tibetan people inside Tibet, they are sending their children to India to study, to meet His Holiness, to study properly. But somehow, after 2008, they have stopped the border. Not people coming from Tibet is very limited. Otherwise, lots of people come from Tibet here in exile to study. So that's why it's a kind of, when they come, we know inside story. And then like these days, due to online, internet, lots of facilities, you can have a border exchange with the people inside.
Yeah. Can you tell me some about your time in the Tibetan Youth Congress? Maybe just how long you were a part of it, if you're still active in it today in any form, just some experiences you had.
Okay, like as I briefly told you about my hunger strike, like protests in Moscow, protests in Delhi, so those things happened when I was in TYC. I got elected to the Vice President of the Tibetan Youth Congress in 1995 for two terms. Again, I got elected in 1998. Each term is for 3 years. I served Tibetan Youth Congress Central Body for almost 6 years as Vice President. And those days, our duty is to keep Tibetan issue alive, to do political rallies in Delhi, to do the education. Not only that, also we have to do lots of social service also, helping Tibetan community, building toilets, bathrooms, and cleaning the road. When His Holiness gives teachings, like culture teaching in Indian towns and cities, we used to do a social service like that. So lots of, TYC was a kind of, it's a wonderful organization, although they claim for independence. It's not only the organization, it's also an organization to train Tibetan youth. When Tibetan youth first go to colleges, at the colleges we have regional Tibetan youth congresses. They can also join regional youth congresses and then can be a member, then can be a leader of the regional chapter also, then can get re-elected to the central board, like that. It's a kind of training ground. If you look at the President Sikyong, the Prime Minister, and some of the ministers in the government, and people like myself in the parliament, we are few, and then people in the government, most of them were working for TYC before. Then later, after a certain time, we have an age limit, then you have to leave TYC. Now it's a kind of training ground also. It's not only to give the issue alive, but also training for the Tibetan youth. See, NGO can play lots of role. Earlier we used to call Tibetan government in exile before 2011. After 2011, we changed it to Tibetan administration, okay? So anyway, whatever you call, this is the supreme body to represent Tibetan in and outside Tibet. But it's being a kind of government, it has certain limitations. Then you have to respect the Indian law, like that. So NGO doesn't have that much limitation. So that's why TYC plays a very big role in Tibetan struggle. It was founded in 1970, October 7. Since then, for the last 45-6 years, TYC has served Tibetan community immensely, not only politically, but also educationally, socially, culturally, like that. Yeah.
And you believe it's a training ground to go further into politics in Tibetan?
Definitely. Yeah, they still do youth leadership training. I used to attend their training as one of the trainer, like that. So they still do training. They still, like they have their own, like TYC is totally a kind of like a very democratic body. It's the highest body is called general body meeting. When we have a general body meeting TYC every 3 years, in the general body meeting, all the policies, major activities are discussed and passed in the general body meeting. And then also the executive body, members of the executive committee, is also elected in up to every 3 years in the GBM. The second highest body is called working committee meeting, which is held after every year. Then CENTREX, Central Executive Committees, like that. So it's a kind of democratic process. Every Tibetan who is a member of TYC can stand for regional chapter, can stand for central chapter, then can serve Tibetan community. It's a kind of platform for the Tibetan youth, no matter you are from which region. But for the ordinary member, we don't have an age limit. Only for the CENTREX, we have a certain limit. Because you have to attend many international meetings. If you, like 50 plus, still say, I'm a member of TYC, people will laugh at you. But ordinarily, we have a member who is as old as 60 plus years. What we are saying, we are old by age, but you are still young at heart to serve the community. So that's why age is not a barrier. Only as a central body, we have certain age limit below 40, like that. Otherwise, ordinary member, we can have any age limit. There's no limit. So as long as you want to serve the community.
Would you say that the Tibetan Youth Congress has any influence on policies or decisions being made in parliament?
It depends. It depends. Certain issue we do have, but like right now, like since 1970, before Tibetan government like Aksai also stands was for independence. TYC, when it was founded, till today, its fight, its struggle is for the full independence of Tibet. But whereas government exile, or what we call Central Tibetan Administration, we are seeking genuine autonomy within the framework of Chinese constitution. So that's quite a little different. But still, we can have differences, because we are in a democratic society, unlike China, where only 9 people rules. But here in exile, every Tibetan has its own say. In the parliament, we are 44 members of parliament right now. It will be 45 members when the next election comes. We had very recently increased one seat, and all these members represent different regions, different provinces, different sects, different communities in the West, like that. So, basically, I got elected because I did a wonderful work when I was in TYC. Like that, we have many people who got elected in the House with the TYC background also. So that was a kind of little influence. But policy-wise, it also depends. I cannot say directly influence right now, but still, it has its own say. Yeah.
What made you interested in getting involved in politics?
See, I told you, like, from right from school, I was little, like, I was a class monitor, I was a school captain, I was a housemaster, like that. So, little, and then used to bunk my classes time and again. Like, when I was studying at university, I also, like, helping the Tibetan patients coming there. So, I also missed so many classes. And then, if you don't have a certain percentage, you will be difficult, you cannot sit for exam like that. Then if you donate blood, then also you get some class, like that. So I was a little involved in politics right from the beginning, when I was in high school, yeah.
What was your reaction when the Dalai Lama announced the stance with the middle way policy and seeking autonomy with China?
No, see, His Holiness has tried all his best. So see, like right now, why he had come down from independence to middle way approach? Because see, the main thing is inside Tibet, the identity, the culture, everything is dying. So that's why then we are hardly 130,000-140,000 in exile. And then the majority inside Tibet, if Tibetan people inside Tibet, culture, everything's crushed down, then it's difficult. So that's why that very reason to keep our culture, language, everything intact, identity alive, and that it's a high time to seek solution. And then that's why His Holiness made his own statement. But then again, like he, then there was no reaction from China side. What happened, like he first made statement in 1987, the 5-point peace plan in the US Congress, one of the committees of US Congress, not in the Congress, okay. So there he made a statement about 5-point peace plan. There he said he wanted to seek a kind of zone of peace for Tibet. Tibet be a buffer zone between India and China. But then that was later elaborated in the Strasbourg European Parliament in 1988, which is called Strasbourg Statement. Then we had little chance. Then some delegation from Tibetan community, His Holiness brother, some of the cabinet, some of the members of secretariat went to Tibet 2, 3, 4 times. Then we had some sort of dialogue, but somehow it failed. Then His Holiness said now he tried his best, but still there was no proper reaction from China side. Now he wanted to consult the people. He made this statement in 1994-5, March 10 statement, Tibet National Aboriginal Statement, made very clear. Then the referendum issue came up. I used to be in the TYC, Vice President. The Tibetan government in exile used to conduct a referendum. And we were saying no referendum until Tibet is free. Because 130,000 Tibetans cannot decide the future of 6 million Tibetans inside Tibet. How can we decide on their behalf? We were saying no referendum. But somehow we didn't have a referendum. We had an opinion polling. Within the option, there were 4 options. One was independence, one was middle way approach, another was Satyagraha, and then another was self-determination. Within these 4 options, we had an opinion polling, but somehow 1997, July 31st, what happened, like majority people said, we don't want referendum, we want His Holiness to decide whatever the good is for Tibet. Looking at the, considering the international politics, considering the Chinese reaction, considering the world support. That was the decision made by the Tibetan group. Almost 66% made that decision. On that very basis, the parliament passed a resolution saying that whatever His Holiness says, we will listen. That time, I was in TYS, okay. Then what happened, like, and His Holiness, when parliament passed the resolution, 1997, September, then that resolution went to His Holiness. His Holiness says, he still will wait for some ideas from people inside Tibet. Then 1998, Martin statement, he said, he tried his best. He gave opportunity to the public to do a kind of referendum. Within the opening polling, you people said, whatever I see good, I have to decide. So he said, for him right now, middle way is the best. So that was how, then that was backed by parliament. So it's not only his idea. Idea came from him, but parliament also endorses it. Then we had a special meeting like that. So that's the long process. Then in the special meeting and general body meeting of the Tibetan community, where 400 plus delegates all over the world came from almost 30 plus countries, people were here to discuss the future of Tibet. And almost 90+ percent says we still must give opportunity to China to reckon. Because middle way policy is very good. It's not only talking about the well-being of Tibetan, it's talking about the well-being of Chinese also. Whereas Tibet belongs to us, but still we are compromising. Because to keep our culture, these days, like he gave example, European Union. Every country is independent, but still why they want to be stay in Union? Why Berlin Wall broke? Like that. So here, of course, within China, we can also live, where we can keep our culture, language, politics, everything alive. And at the same time, China can also take care of us, like that. That was the main idea. But somehow, unfortunately, China doesn't listen to us. That's the biggest problem. Yeah.
What would you say the general population of Tibetans agree with, autonomy or independence?
See, like if you ask every people, for them it's very difficult, it's a very emotional decision. So many people from heart, they might think independence, but again, when it comes to issue, oh, we need to go back to Tibet fast, maybe people think that middle way approach will be sooner, whereas every single world leader, they talk of democracy, they talk of human rights, they talk of development, they talk of coexistence, but somehow when it comes to China, business is first. Okay, that's the strategy for us. That's why if you talk of independence, no country will support us. So if you talk of middle way approach, only one China policy, then for them the world leader is easier. Like this, so many situations, the inside condition, our culture being dying inside, language being dying inside, world pressure, like that. So I think looking at these countries, people in exile, maybe majority believes in middle way approach. One, because of His Holiness' view, another because of the present condition, so that's the thing. But inside Tibet, there are people who believe in independence, who believe in middle way approach. For us, whatever you say, whether middle way or approach, China is our enemy. We have a fight with China. So we are in the exile community, we are in a democratic society, where we can have different views. But China, you cannot say anything, only nine people decide. So here in exile, we have a democracy, so that's the thing. Then that's how we. Then TYC, 2 years back, they passed a resolution saying their stand is for independence. But when issue is resolved, if issue is resolved tomorrow, what they said, what the Tibetan people will decide, they will also follow same. So that's the kind of change they made 2 years back in their general body meeting.
Karma, it sounds like you are very understanding of the middle way policy, but you were also in the Tibetan Youth Congress that supported independence.
Yeah, yeah.
So right now, would you say that you support autonomy or independence?
No, see, like saying directly, I support autonomy, I don't support independence. See, and nobody, every Tibetan wants freedom. Every Tibetan wants us to go back to Tibet. Of course, I have a full freedom here in India. I can do any study, I can do any business. I have full freedom, I can protest in Delhi in front of Chinese embassy, like that. But still, your country is your country. Going back to Tibet is more important. And then this question, like what I support, of course, definitely my heart says independence. But again, like given the situation, and then again, you have to resolve the issue. When His Holiness 80 plus, is 81, but according to the Western age, is going to be 80 very soon. But our tradition, we say once you're born, 9 months in, we believe that also. So that's why I say he is also very old. We want issue to be resolved in his lifetime. We want him, when we get back to Tibet, we also need him to administration to seek his guidance and all. But still, that's why whatever is good for Tibet is good for us.
And the parliament supports autonomy publicly.
Yeah, that's true.
Would you say a lot of people in the parliament are like you and in their heart support independence?
No, that again, I cannot say on behalf of all the Tibetan parliamentarians, but there are some, of course, there are some who openly also says in the house that I stand for independence, Rangzin, but the majority, parliament has passed a resolution unanimously some years back. We have to respect that. That's our own resolution. So respecting, as an official, officially, because I also am Karma. Karma as a, when you separate Karma from member of parliament, I have my own views. And as an official member of parliament, you have to also stick to the official line. So like that. So you have to be very careful. When you wear a hat, red hat, you have to be like red hat. When you put up your red hat and wear some other hat, you do like that. But anyway, the resolution of Tibet issue is the first. And looking at the age of His Holiness, we want him to live 1,000 years, but we know he's not going to live. Because he, of course, we believe him as a reincarnation, kind of manifestation of our Lokiteshvara. But still, he came in this world as a human being. He had to live like a human being. So we want issue to resolve. And then for China also, he is a kind of key. They should use him. When he is alive, it's the right time for China to use the right opportunity, right movement, right person to engage with him, his representative, to resolve the issue when he is alive. It will also benefit China. Once he is, because no more, then it will be difficult for us and it will be difficult for China also. You never know. Right now, so when he is alive, China should use this opportunity. They consider him like demon, they consider him as a separatist, but he is the key for the resolution of China-Tibet issue. Not only for China-Tibet issue, but for world peace also, like that. So they should use his lifetime, definitely. I think it's high time for China to use.
So are you saying that if the issue is going to be resolved, it will be while the Dalai Lama is still alive?
Yeah, no, see, it's better for us. See, we see the independence of India. I had no single contribution in Indian struggle independence, but I'm enjoying the Indian independence, okay? In independent India, so I'm enjoying it. People like Mahatma Gandhi, people like Subhash Chandra Bose, they died for Indian struggle, but still I'm enjoying. So that's why right now the condition of India you can see, the condition of many African countries you see, independent countries, terrible. The situation is worse than us, but still going back to Tibet is one issue, but at the same time, how are you going to run that future Tibet is another issue. So that's why a long time back, His Holiness said, Constitution of Tibet and Future Vision of Tibet, he had published a book long time back, seeing the future vision of Tibet. Earlier we used to say Constitution of Tibet, now you cannot say that. When you're talking about middle way approach, there is no Constitution of India, Tibet as such, but still the future vision. So that's why, like this present system, whatever we have right now, the Prime Minister, elected members of Parliament, or Speaker, or different departments, these all are temporary. Once we get to Tibet, it will dissolve automatically. Then we have an interim government that will decide. So that's why this is a kind of practice what we are doing. So that's why we need him when Tibet, we back to Tibet for another few years. So that we can also, so he is a source of inspiration. He's a source of unity for us. He's a source of peace for us. He's everything for us. That's why whatever he say, even the people who believe in independence, they also, for them also, he's their leader. No matter that. Now His Holiness has left politically. Executive power, everything he left in 2011. So all the powers were delegated to the elected leaders. So that's why. So why he did so? Because he want us to take burden on our shoulder. So that's why 50 years in exile experience now, it's high time for us to take our, the burden on our shoulder. If he is His Holiness for us, we have to keep him like His Holiness. Not that he should go everywhere back for us, support for us, like that. So that's why. For the very well-being of Tibetan people, he left all these political powers. Whereas in the other parts, the Middle East and other parts, world leaders are hunger for their power. People want them to out, but they want power. Like here, We want him, but he is saying he will not leave. That doesn't mean that he is leaving the Tibet issue, no. But again, he is giving. In a particular family also, when you grow up, you give charge to your son, like that. So that's why it's a high time for us. This is not a struggle of one person. It's a struggle of 6 million Tibetans. It's a struggle related to the well-being of all Himalayan regions. If Tibet becomes a tomorrow a kind of buffer state, a peace zone, it will definitely benefit both India and Tenten. This whole Tenten will resolve. So that's why it's a high time to world leaders to support. Yeah.
Could you share with us anything that's being discussed in Parliament right now, or any steps being made towards helping the middle way policy work?
You see, like middle way policy is the official stand of the Tibetan government, and they have been doing their work, campaigning everywhere in the world. But see, the Parliament, again, unlike other Parliament, okay, where Indian Parliament or US Congress or whatever, they discuss budget, everything. But they do not discuss budget single. But here, every single budget, every single account has been read out in the House and debated. Like, see, what happened, very recently we had a March. March is mostly a budget session. And this time, like, it was almost 2018 million rupees, which is annual budget, estimated budget of the expenses of Tibetan setup in exile all over the world. And what we do, like, all the Tibetan settlements, all the Tibetan hospitals, schools, whatever the budget, they send their budget to the different concerned department, and they sent to finance department. Finance department made a whole budget. And before we discuss in the House, we have a budget committee of the Parliament. Budget committee meet for almost 15 days before, which it has almost 5 members, and they discuss everything. They can also call on minister, they can call on secretaries, accountants, discuss, like that. So every single the budget is totally discussed. Not a single penny of the Central Tibetan Administration cannot be used without the sanction of the House. Not a single penny cannot be received without the sanction of the Tibetan Parliament. Every single policy, whatever, is debated. So I think Parliament, we have a full kind of democratic form. And every now and then we raise question to the Sikyong, the Prime Minister, different concerned ministers. They have to, the upcoming session will be in September. It's a kind of annual report. Every different minister have to present their report, and we'll also have a deliberation over the report. And as a member of parliament, since we are elected on the basis of province, like Tibet traditionally we have 3 provinces: Central Tibet we call Yusang, then Eastern Tibet we call Kham, then Northeastern Tibet we call Amdo. These 3 provinces, here in exile, the people from Yusang, Central Tibet, bigger number. But still this parliament represents both in and outside Tibet. So we have 10 seats each from 3 provinces. Then Tibetan Buddhism, we have 4 different schools of Tibetan Buddhism: Gelug, Nyingma, Sakya, Kagyu. Okay, this school plus pre-Buddhist religion, our own religion before Buddhism came to Tibet, called Bon. These 5 different schools of have 2 seats each. That is 10, 30, 40. And Tibetans living in North America and South America, we recently changed. And they can elect 2. And then Tibetans living in Europe and Africa, they can elect 2. 44. And then we have given 1 additional seat very recently. Besides, like you say, Australasia country, like for example, Australia, Singapore, Taiwan, Japan, like that, where we have some Tibetans, they can elect 1. So this is 45. So all the members of parliament, they do not sit in the House permanently. And we are only 11 members of parliament, 2 each from 3 different provinces, 1 each from 4 or 5 different schools of thought, sit in the office permanently to do the work. So that's how we discuss everything here.
What is your role in parliament?
Right now, I'm in the political committee. We, in the standing committee, out of 11, we have 3 committees. One is administration committee, and one is political committee, one is general committee. Then administration committee looks after the, deals with the administration of the CTA. And political committee, we regularly looks at what China is doing, what world is doing, what is Tibet. So I'm the political committee, so that's my main role. And we also have a budget committee, then we also have a public accounts committee. Every single office of Tibetan government in exile, plus its subordinate bodies, are audited properly by the Tibetan Audit Department. When audit report comes, the Public Accounts Committee looks after the audit report to do the follow-up. Every single office is audited properly, audited by the Indian audit also, for the sake of Indian government, audited by the our own audit department for our sake, like that. So it's double audited. Then every single audit report is discussed in the PAC, Public Accounts Committee. We present a thorough report, which is tabled in the House. I was secretary of the audit PAC in the last session. So then all the parliament procedures, live telecast through online, plus live telecast through all over Dharamsala, through cable network, yeah, like that.
On a bit of a different note, do you believe in your in the Dalai Lama's lifetime he will return to Tibet?
Yeah, definitely, yes. Because see, like, of course it seems a little difficult, but still, I have seen Sudan became, South Sudan became independent. In my lifetime, I've seen East Timor became independent. Jose Ramos Horta, when I was in Geneva, I used to meet him time and again. He was lobbying for the East Timor case in United Nations. People were inside country, they were there during their fight. And in my lifetime, I've seen East Timor became independent. Okay, then why not Tibet? So like that, so Bangladesh created newly. And then all these USSR broke, so many countries became independent. But becoming a free country is a different issue than having your own identity. If you look at the Uzbekistan, Tajikistan, Kyrgyzstan, unfortunately, they're all an independent country. But unfortunately, they don't speak their language. They have lost. They only speak Russian. So here in our case, if we get a free Tibet tomorrow, if you speak Chinese, if you speak Indian, if you lose your culture, your identity, that independence is useless. That is why we should keep everything alive here. Your good qualities, your good culture, your language, identity. Then get back to Tibet, you can practice. So otherwise, you are independent country like other these who are got independent from USSR, but they unfortunately they don't speak their language, then it's no point. So I have some friends in Uzbekistan. I used to tell them, so you should try to learn your own language, create school. Luckily here in exile we have all every setup. So that's why we can at least preserve, protect, so that once you get with Tibet, whatever Tibet we get, within or free, but still we can use. So these things, I think definitely we should have a hope. You never know, I think China will break down. Because see, China has a huge problem within China. If you look at China, Eastern Turkestan, okay, another issue for the Uyghur people, big issue. Then Tibet, not an easy issue for them. They thought when His Holiness left Tibet, some 80,000 Tibetans followed him in the year 1959. They thought 30 years later, Tibet will die. It's still very much alive. Then democratic movement inside Tibet, Falun Gong movement, Hong Kong people, they said Hong Kong, one country, two cities, but still people are not happy. You have seen lots of revolution inside Hong Kong, Macau also. These all things happen like that, so huge problem. Then one biggest is huge gap between rich and poor. If you look at China, many Chinese, they are not happy, but they cannot raise their voice. All these different issues within China is our positive side, is our strength. So I'm not saying that we should unite and fight China, but still we have a hope. So that's why China should now engage His Holiness when he is alive and is resolved the issue. And then I think sooner or later, people inside China, they are not happy with the Chinese leaders, with the Communist Party. So that's why they have to change. If they really want to become world leader, if you really want to see, economically they are growing. When they allow world leader or world businessman to come to invest, with the business, many things open. Okay, these days world is very small. People inside Tibet, they are doing a self-immolation, they are doing a hunger strike, they are doing a lot of demonstration. Today they do a demonstration, self-immolation. Next day we get a video clipping. Yeah. All this, so they are stopping every single measure, using every single measure to stop. But still, technology, new social media helps us a lot. It can cross border very easily like that. So huge, I think a big hope for us that I think during His Holiness lifetime, we'll be able to go back to Tibet. But that what Tibet will be, again, it depends. China should have a willpower. That they must have a political will to resolve the issue.
You say you're very happy here in India with like the freedom it provides you. So if Tibet were to become autonomous or even independent, would you want to return to Tibet, or are you pretty satisfied here?
No, that when I say happy, that but still, you are Tibetan, living in exile. Whenever I travel, earlier we used to have a called RC, residential certificate. Every year you have to renew. Now it's 5 years. So, okay. Every single 5 years you have to go, oh, this is my... I think that, oh, I'm a member of parliament, I do business, I do this. But still, you are temporary here. So, of course, you have a freedom. Thanks to India, thanks to Indian people, thanks to Indian government. But still, this is not your country. Your country is behind the Himalayas, so you have to go there. So, I'm not here to settle down. My parents didn't come to Tibet to settle down, India to settle down. But slowly we are settling down. Because once you are exiled, you have to live. You have to take care of your children. You have to live, you have to survive, you have to do this. But still, this is not your destination. Your destination is back in Tibet. So definitely, majority will go back. Me too.
I have one last question for you. What are your hopes for the future of Tibet?
Where in the sense?
Just your hopes for Tibet, what you see, like the
people. I think like Tibet has a great hope. If you look at, see, like especially inside Tibet, see, despite Chinese control, despite Chinese pressure, people are doing lots of protest. And then especially the Tibetan Buddhist teachers, when they travel to China, some of them are huge followers of Chinese Buddhists. Why they are not allowing His Holiness to go to China? Why they are not allowing His Holiness to visit Tibet? Like that. So I think if once, we don't have any single hatred with Chinese people. It's only the communist regime. It's only the party. It's only the government. But Chinese, they are also suffering under their regime. So that's why if these Chinese people inside China and the Tibetan people, we try to know each other what we stand for, from where you want freedom. So that's why I think if we try to know each other, as His Holiness said, his hope on the Chinese leaders are getting smaller and smaller, but his hope with the people of China is big, I think, still very big. So that's why we need to have a man-to-man contact with the people of China. Definitely, then they will realize, understand our issue, and definitely, once they understand, because right now they are only told by the Chinese regime, Tibet was part of China, Tibet was like this, Tibet like that. So it's their mindset which has to change. Once they come to exile, once they, like Chinese students studying in different universities in the West, some of them were tough. Many of them were, when we talk to them one to one, they understand us. Then many of them come to Dharamsala, they meet His Holiness, they cry in front of Him, they also say sorry on their regime's behalf, like that. So definitely, if Chinese people understand our real thing, we will, the hope for Tibet. Again, the Tibetan culture, Tibetan Buddhism, His Holiness not promoting Buddhism, but his the values of Buddhism, which is good for every single human being, whether you're a believer or non-believer, like that. So this culture must kept alive, not for the sake of Tibetan alone, but for the sake of world. So it's very important. On one hand, the Tibet, the place is very high, it's a plateau, and then it can play a huge balancing of power between India and China, the future world powers, okay? That we don't want tension. So like that, it can play a big role. Then again, like sources of many rivers of India and China are from Tibet. So like Tibet, protection of Tibet environment, ecology is essential. That's why Tibet has a great hope. Not for the sake of Tibetan political issue, even for the sake of preserving the water ecology, world must support. So I think if you look at this angle, I think we have a great hope.
What do you think it would take for the Chinese to change their mindset?
You see, because we need to understand Chinese mindset. They need to understand our mindset. Because right now, we think China is our enemy. And then Chinese, they say, oh, Tibet. Some of them left Tibet, and His Holiness Dalai Lama, some 130,000, they are separatists. Well, Tibet is a part like that. So understanding one another's mindset, their culture, their behavior, we should learn. We being a Tibetan, it's very important for us to learn their culture, their behavior, and they should learn our behavior. When you know each other, definitely, I think it will definitely resolve many issues. Then political issues are as a matter of time. Anything can happen. Yeah, only the time matters. No? So when iron becomes hot, then we need to hammer. So one day iron will definitely become hot, That time we need to hammer properly. That time will come for us.
Thank you so much, Karma, for talking to me and taking time out to share your story with all of us.
Thank you.
Too cliche.